conditions created by lack of money, more than 75 BBC producers left the BBC and staked all their programme budgets on a horse race.
Over the first, to the Man of War, then Delia Smith's Soup Course, Dick Emery, Life on Earth, and there goes the Director General's drinks. BBC Two Spanish opera season leading the weather forecast, and huge fat drunks playing darts, and James Burke in the blinkers. Blankety Blank, Open University Physics Course. Oh my goodness, the opera's gone. And large, and this is unbelievable, and the Dimbleby lecture is down, and Marty Kane and Bill Cotton. Lunch is over, and there's Richard Baker down. So the makeup lady's running off the course of the Grecian 2000, and it's absolutely chaos. Chaos down there. No, that's not a riderless horse. Horizon of Gamble on a microchip jockey. Cyril Fletcher seems to be making a run for it on foot. And the race is going. They've restarted, and my goodness, yes, it is. It's not the 9 o'clock meeting.
In a typical year, the BBC has £340 million to allocate, so how do we cut up the cake? Well, this 7.7% goes on investment credit. This 2.2% goes on artists, musicians, and so forth. This 14.3% goes on technical requirements. This 16.1% goes on forward planning and regional development. And this 59.7% goes on cake.
Here are the main points again.
Jeddah. In his new budget, the Chancellor of Saudi Arabia has put 20 lashes on a bottle of whiskey.
Art experts admit that another of the National Gallery's collection is not by John Constable, but is in fact by his son, William.
Well,
we'd like something to eat, please.
I'll be the judge of that.
What do you want? What would you like, dear?
I think I have one of those, please.
Yes, I think I will as well. Can we have two of these, please?
Impossible, I'm afraid.
Don't you do them?
Look, you're not allowed to point at the menu to show me what you want. You have to tell me.
All right, two hamburgers, please.
What burgers?
Hamburgers.
It doesn't say hamburger on the menu, now does it?
I don't see that
make... Stop whining! Ask for it properly. Read out exactly what it says on the menu, if you would, please.
God. I'll have two beefy brunch benders.
Beefy what, sir?
Brunch benders.
I can't hear you, sir.
Look, for goodness sake.
Say it!
Two beefy brunch benders.
It's beefy, sir. It's got seven E's in it, all right?
Do I have to do this?
I'm waiting. Come on. I'm
two
waiting.
Beefy brunch
That's
benders.
That's only three E's. I said seven E's. Beefy.
Two beefy.
Brunch, but now louder!
Two beefy
Brunchbenders.
Brunchbenders. Good. Now the rest of it. Leave him alone. He's going to do this by himself.
No, please, I don't...
Come on, what sort of spineless cretin are you?
Two beefy brunchbenders smothered in scrumptious fried onion and...
No, I didn't say crispy. And crispy has a K.
Crispy.
Crispy. Good, now from the top, through this loud hailer, if you would, sir. Stand up and move, okay?
Bendy brunchbenders smothered in scrumptious crispy fried onion.
And the price altogether? Right, then they're nicely. Turn two hamburgers here, table four.
To drool. If you wanna have a boy,
a little joke like that costs to tell. First, you need writers, 34 of them at £9 each. Then there's the writer's coffee, £53.07. Then there's the whole production team, camera crew, electricians, secretaries, and so on, 47 of them, and to be honest, none of them exactly underpaid. Well, now we come to the sketch itself. You need performers, and the performers need clothes. Griff's alpaca scarf is by Givenchy and costs £25. His Shetland loafer jacket costs £230. His Pierre Cardin jeans cost £73. The crowbar used in this sequence is in hand-tempered Swedish steel by Sebastian. Now, to avoid the risk of advertising, the car itself had to be custom-built for the BBC. It's an exact replica of a 1973 Vanden Plas Princess Royale. The wall you see in the background is 14th century Italian. Probably from Siena. And of course, I don't come cheap either.
Reagan. Carter. Kennedy. Bush. Don't you think American voters deserve a real alternative? Relax, you've got one. He's clean, honest, highly intelligent. He's Dwight F. Monroe. This time, get it right. Put Dwight F. Monroe and his charming wife, Darlene, in the White House. Why vote Dwight? Here's why.
Well, he's never destroyed any part of Southeast Asia. Yet.
Nobody's going to assassinate him. He's a protected species.
A lot of politicians think they can walk on water. Well, this guy can.
He and Darlene like to keep things informal. He likes people. All kinds of people. Especially young people. He's not afraid to speak out on the issue.
He gets around a lot better than George Wallace.
He's a better swimmer than Teddy Kennedy.
Meet the new boss.
time, don't make do with a human being. Go for the best. Vote Dwight F. Monroe for a sense of porpoise.
Yeah, I think I've learned a great lesson from Chappaquiddick. It is a lesson that could benefit a great number of my fellow Americans. And the lesson is, don't drive across narrow bridges when you're pissed out of your mind.
Welcome. My special guest tonight is a very remarkable man. From the humblest beginnings, he's risen overnight from obscurity to oblivion. After being thwarted in his earliest ambition to be a flying nun by failing the medical, he took up a career in sport. In 1952, he was domino champion of Clacton, but his finest sporting achievement was when he once shared a girlfriend with Georgie Best. Since that time, he's conquered the world of showbiz. His sex appeal has earned him the title of the thinking woman's Risso. A critic once said of him, and I quote, he is to conversation what Danny LaRue is to rugby league. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Parkinson. Mike, it's marvelous to meet you. I mean, I really am a great fan of yours, and I want to tell you how delighted I am to meet you and to have you on my show.
Well, it's nice of you to say so, and I can only admire your taste.
Kidney donor.
Why not? Come on, I mean, why? Why can't
I? Go away, please, Mr. Harris.
Well, come on, I mean, you've let others be present at the birth. You've let others hold the mother's hand and share with her the wonderful experience of childbirth.
Only if they're the father.
God's greatest wonder. Go
Apparently,
away.
It's the most beautiful and humbling experience.
Go away.
Apparently.
And go I mean, away. Go
away. You know, darling, what could be better than this? A nice, quiet evening at home.
A roaring fire.
Beethoven playing in the background.
A nice Chinese in the oven.
And boxing on the television. I know.
And I love
you. New air safety regulations out today make it compulsory for all British aeroplanes to carry lifeboats.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Captain Wang and his crew welcome you aboard flight 1203 to Los Angeles. We hope you'll have a pleasant flight and that we don't encounter any turbulence and crash the plane. For your own safety and convenience, please locate the instruction card in the pouch in front of you. It is situated between the crumpled magazine with the Robert Morley interviews and the piece of orange peel. We would like to stress that in the unlikely event of anything going wrong, any attempt to escape from the aircraft is futile. Please fasten your safety belt and extinguish your cigarette. Shame though it is to waste your last one. When disaster strikes, there may be a slight loss of cabin pressure and a reduction in the number of wings. In this event, a plastic mask will automatically drop down. Place it over your nose and pull hard to release the oxygen. Then attempt to fit the broken cord back into the hole from which the air is. is now pouring. Please note that your life jacket is under your seat. It is impossible to get it out, particularly with your seatbelt on, so we have one already prepared here. Place it over your head, then tie the straps around you. To inflate, pull the green tag, press the yellow button, unzip the toggle pocket, unscrew the air valve anti-clockwise, and yell, "Inflate, you stupid bugger." Next, remove from your person any sharp objects, such as fragments of red-hot engine casing, and make your way to the escape rooms. These are located over the wings, so you people there, there, and there have absolutely no chance, and we apologize for having wasted your time. Well, enough of this maudlin talk. This has been your chief stewardess speaking, and demonstrating the regulations was Lola, who's a right little strumpet and willing to oblige you in any way at all. Captain Wang and his crew wish you a very short and pleasant flight.
That's right, I'm over here. Well, even if you can't see me very well, I believe at least you can hear me. Now, one of the worst things about these cuts, I'm afraid, is the way they're going to affect the quality of the cinematography. That is, the way the pictures are taken. This shot, for instance, is an incredibly expensive shot taken from a helicopter. That's you up there, and I'm all the way down here. And this sort of thing costs an obscene amount of money. My God, if you knew how much helicopters and all that jazz cost to get together, you'd be a very reluctant renewer of your TV license, I can tell you. I won't keep you.
Welcome to Badminton, where a large crowd are enjoying themselves in the full expectation of seeing a gang of horsey snobs falling slap into the mire, getting filthy, and making fools of themselves. Straight away over to the trout hatchery, Lucinda Pryor Palmer approaching, so fingers crossed, I can assure those of you at home that a good half gallon of dirty water has just shot straight up that upper-class hyphenated nose. I speak for everyone when I say, serves you right, Miss Hoity-Toity, and Roberta Flavel James. And she's coming up, Trout Hatchery, again, and this is terrific. I really think she may have hurt herself quite badly, too, judging from the way the crowd is laughing. So now that we moved on to watch riders over the more simple fences... not going to, because it's not really as much fun as watching pompous knobs flopping about in mucky ditches. Barnes Markham, will he get a mouthful? Yes. Interesting to think, isn't it, just what previous horses would have deposited in the water. And another one. Whoopsie daisy there, mate. And another one. Well, we're having a bit of fun here today. And just in a minute, I think it's the moment. Yes, here we are. It's the moment that everyone who hates rich people and horses has been waiting for. It's Princess Anne herself, approaching the Trout Hatchery. And wouldn't it be wonderful if she prized us all and rode straight into a tree instead? Yes, she has!
Hello. This is a model of the set we were going to use at this point in the programme. But when we discovered it was going to cost £500 to build this set, we thought, well, that's a bloody waste of money, isn't it? I mean, if you said to someone, what would you prefer, to hear a good joke or have £500, there aren't many who would prefer the good joke. So instead of building this set, we've decided to offer the cash, the £500, to anyone who wants it, to anyone who feels as though they ought to have more money than they have at present. So if you're poor and in need, or if you're rich and greedy, please don't delay, but write to us at this address.
I want a lot more money, i.e. £500, not the 9 o'clock news, BBC Television Centre, Wood Lane, London W12.
Enclosing a photograph of yourself and a cheque or postal order for £5. The first 100 applications received will have the prize divided between them. In case you think it's immoral to give away money like this, there is a competition element. Thinking up any word that rhymes with set will qualify you to win the prize. Words like net, bet, and get are all perfectly all right. Right, well, while we've got the set here, we thought we may as well do the sketch that we were going to do at this point. And I was going to play Mark Phillips, right. and Mel here was...
Princess Anne,
that's right. And so you're on the set.
Yes, this is in the new lounge at Gatcombe Park.
That's right.
Okay, and I'm just sort of hoovering.
That's right.
Oh dear, these hooves get everywhere. Oh, come on, Mark. Late again.
Home, darling.
Hello, darling.
All right, Range Rover, you can go.
Want a drink, darling?
No, thanks. Just get these off, will you? Now listen, about these cuts. I'm afraid we're getting a lot of stick from the pros about this rise.
How beastly!
So I'm afraid we're going to have to cut back a bit.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we need to redecorate the horses' bedrooms as often as we have.
I could always stop pouring champagne down the sink, darling.
No, don't do that. We never get rid of it any other way.
Oh, unless we invited the hunt round more often. Ah, here they are now.
Mr. Mugabe and Mr. Nkomo of Zimbabwe and more than 2,000 former guerrillas have sent me a little note praising my pronunciation.
And news of a compromise solution to the Tehran problem. Following last week's operation in Egypt, the Shah's spleen has been extradited to Iran to stand trial for crimes against Islam.
Yes.